So the fact that social proof is a problem is not a problem in itself, but it's also something which can be manipulated, right? The Russian involvement in the US election, which is an open and shut case. It's just that the Americans are going around in circles, figuring out did the Russians involve in the elections or not. It's an open and shut case. They did. And now there's even evidence coming out that the Russians might have involved themselves in the Brexit vote. Now, if you have massive manipulation of public opinion by outsiders or by vested interests, then the whole idea that, you know, individuals will select a government or a politician based on their likes, it just goes for a toss. So that's why I'm worried about it.
Great point. Both of you have made excellent points.
But I differ.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Strongly.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a mic here. You know, about the level of discourse. Firstly, the fact that, you see, prior to social media, each one of us had a peer group whose pressure weighed us down. Whether you were, you know, teaching in a university or you were an artist or whatever. Our peer group was small and their pressure intense. If you fell out of line, well, that's the end of you. I face that all the time. Because always had this off the beaten track approach, not because I chose it, it so happened. Now, with social media, what's happened is, like for example, I gave the example of how when I did the Modi book, all my liberal left, whatever, friends just abused me and disowned me, and I found once another set of. The moment Modi came to power, I began critiquing some of the things he was doing. So all the pro-Modi gang or the pro-Modi followers were so devastated. What's gone wrong with you? Have you gone mad? What are you doing? Is it you talking? Is somebody had? But I got another set, a much larger set of people, who then began to see that I would deal with issues on merit, that I don't want to belong to this or that. And every time you get exposed to newer and newer groups of people, it's not just one set of people. Secondly, as far as the level of public discourse is concerned, I find that it's up to you to decide how to respond. For example, there have been many occasions when somebody in my defense would abuse somebody else, call them all the filthy names, Maade Inki Gali. And I would at once crack down heavily and say, look, even in my defense, if you dared abuse somebody, I'll block you. Apologize publicly, and then only you have a right to. And believe you me, almost always the person apologized publicly, deleted that offensive, and came back on track. So I don't find many abusive responses. And what is, to me, so enriching is that the moment I make a mistake, either I lapse on some fact, because each one of us operates with very limited understanding of this very complex social reality we operate in, instantly there'll be 10 people who will correct me, who will provide me more information, who will tell me where I went wrong and how to. And for me, it's so enriching. And I'm so grateful to all such people when they catch a mistake I've made. Where else in the world do you get this kind of well-meaning feedback, some nasty also, but as long as there are self-correcting mechanisms. You tell a lie in Times of India or a mainstream TV channel, if they refuse to acknowledge it, there's no way you can fix it. But you tell a lie on social media or present a fake news or distort, there'll be thousands, hundreds of people who will instantly fix things, fix the narrative. Now, this self-correcting mechanism and your choice of what kind of people you deal with and how you deal with abuse, how you bring it down, and if you are courteous in handling with criticism and even thankful when the criticism is valid, believe you me, then it's the kind of guidance, it's the kind of an intellectual enrichment I never got from any of my teachers. I never got from my PhD guide. Itne boring thes, kuch bhi nahi guidance mili. All my life, I've been in search of a guru. I got teachers, mostly in different ones. But social media has given me countless, very interesting, very enlightened, very caring teachers who I'm very grateful to and made me more emotionally resilient.
I think very, very fine perspectives presented by both the speakers. Madhuji, I feel that you can be very courteous on the social media because you have an awe-inspiring personality where the stick is in the shadow. But anyway, coming to this thing, we really appreciate the way you are actually improving the social manners on social media. Everybody is not being able to do that. But coming to the other point, Mr. Modi, that Modi is an antibiotic which was required. I also feel that you and I and everybody should also focus on the side effects of the antibiotic. Otherwise, the juggernaut of any establishment might just go wayward. So this is the point which I would come again to, but before I go to that, the social discourse, once again, let me ask you. Those who invoke our glorious past on social media for greater civility and more refined social interaction, they are usually the ones who are most lacking in social polish. Hum kehte hain, you'll see on social media, you are a link between the classes and the masses, which is why I'm asking you this question. You will see a lot of people on social media saying, "Purani sabhyata pe jao, acha acharan rakho, achi tarah se baat karo vagera." But they are the, if you see their tweets and all, they are the people who are most lacking in social polish. How do you explain this? Do you agree with this? How do you explain this? And what is the remedy for their preaching social civility but engaging in brazenness?
I don't see that. I do see a lot of lumpen elements on social media, but so in our life. If you have an education system as flawed, disastrous, it is mass-producing lumpens. Students don't learn well. You know, the whole countryside is filled with Atmi fail, Nomi na pass, people who've got Barmi ka certificate but can't read two sentences in any language of the world or write even in their mother tongue. When you have produced, mass produced lumpen elements, you're not paying attention to that. You only pay attention to their running amok here, there, wherever. They do wish to be part of. And somebody who's taught in Delhi University for long years before, by the way, I'm no more a professor at CSDS. I am now what they call Maulana Azad National Professor of ICSSR. Bahut bada title hai, but anyway. Bhul jata hai mujhe uska details. Anyway, the point that I'm making is, as somebody who's taught in Delhi University, I feel ashamed to admit that my colleagues in the teaching community would come and play tennis, would come and play cards, would do share bazari in the staff room, not go and teach. This is happening in Delhi University. So one can well imagine teacher absenteeism, lack of teaching skills. When you have that kind of army of lumpen elements, lumpenized youth, Modi ji keeps talking about aspirational India. Yes, they're aspirational, but they don't have any skills to fulfill those aspirations. So that frustration between aspiration, because now you can actually thanks to TV, thanks to social media, actually have a glimpse of the life of the rich and famous, of the elite. Earlier they didn't, so they didn't even know what they really wanted. And you don't pay attention to that, then you will have a certain number of people. And again, India is the only country in the world where people are illiterate in their mother tongue and proud to be so. Angrezi ne sabka band baja diya hai. क्योंकि मदर टंग पढ़नी नहीं, हिंदी आनी नहीं, अंग्रेज ना हिंदी तो substandard नौकरों की भाषा है और अंग्रेजी आनी नहीं. तो ऐसे linguistic cripples हैं, वो social media पे भी वो देखते हैं, फिर वो माँ बहन की गाली तो हर भाषा में आसानी से आ जाती है. So we better pay attention to what is producing the lumpen responses. But those who really believe in our civilizational values, and there are plenty, and the good thing is that they were demeaned for too long. Even to acknowledge them was considered a crime. I remember first time, many, many years ago, when I wore a pendant with the Om written on it, my very leftist colleagues, oh, Hindutvavadi ban gayi, Sanghi ban gayi. Are, Om is the first word our mothers teach us. And that, even that became so suspect. When you demean it so much, then I think that counter assertion is necessary. Some are doing it in a very enlightened manner. Today, the kind of material that I get to read on ancient Indian history, medieval Indian history, I didn't get in my JNU history department, all the scholars that taught me, the great eminent historians, I get much better quality. That's available. But then, of course, there are others who are just expressing their angst. They know something was wrong, but they don't know how to express it because they're not well read. So we better pay attention to our education system and training minds to think, not just go to school and come back with a paper